Talking about orientable cubes, and I will review the main results I have obtained, and because I think that there are techniques, recent techniques coming from the proving of Rota's conjecture on realizability of matroids that have many points in common, and so maybe we can discuss this later. So I'll start by defining what is a cube. And the cube is a matroid over Cn, where Cn is the set of plus minus one vectors. The matroid must satisfy two conditions. One is that every rectangle of Cn, meaning that Euclidean rectangle as a rectangle of Rn, must be a circuit of the matroid. The other one is that every Euclidean facet, nth cube facet, of Cn, meaning of the usual cube, must be an hyperplane and the co-circuit of the matroid. So a cube is any matroid whose underlying matroid is isomorphic to one of those. Immediate examples of cubes are the matroids of affine dependencies of the 0, 1 vectors over any field. One can generate much more cubes because the class of cubes is invariant under the operation of pooling points to hyperplanes, which is the reverse of relaxing. We stress, we don't relax. So what is pooling points to hyperplanes? This comes for the oriented version. Is one has an hyperplane and a point, what we call in general position, meaning that for every hyperline of the hyperplane, and for every hyperplane spanned by a hyperline of the H and the point E, E is actually a co-loop in this hyperplane, meaning there are no other points of the matroid in those hyperplanes. Okay? Whenever we have a point and an hyperplane in general position, we can pull the point to the hyperplane, we just put it there, and what we get is another cube. In this way, this operation does not preserve neither orientability in general nor representability. So from our original family of cubes, affine cubes, we can get easily cubes which are not representable over any field. Now, when we come to orientability of study orientability of this class, what happens so far is that this is a huge class, which is not closed under minors, you know, it's not well behaved under these nice things. But so far, we only know one orientable cube, which is the real affine cube. Whenever this appears, is the real affine cube. Okay? So, how many cubes are owned, orientable? So all our results are, I will point out results in these three order of three aspects. First, general results about orientable cubes. Second, studying obstructions to orientability. And third, and this is now a working process with Emmerich, we are trying to understand better the recursivity, we'll get that there, recursivity and relation between rectangles and hyperplanes. Of course, there is a small, big, important point is that the fine real cube, even in small dimensions, is not explicitly known, so only for small dimensions, very small dimensions. So, concerning general results, they are condensed here. And the general results say the following. Say the following. First of all, every matroid has the expected rank. Second, every orientable cube has a class of orientations, a canonical class of orientations, where the rectangles and the co-circuits of the facets and skew facets are signed, are as oriented, as in the real affine cube. Whatever cube we start with, we can find this canonical orientation. And moreover, if we have the cube canonically oriented, all the reorientations we can get from there with the, whose lattice of faces is isomorphic to the face lattice of the real cube are obtained in the same way, by reversing sides on the facets, okay? Consequences of these main general results. First consequence is that, in fact, there are several, and we have just been seeing one before, several ways of representing oriented matroids as highly symmetric Euclidean objects inside a cube. Every oriented matroid is a, if we think of topes or the crinkles on a tope, can, and what can be thought of as an Euclidean object, highly symmetric inside the cube. What these results say is that actually it, we don't have to care about what orientable matroid we take for this interpretation, because those interpretations only deal with the face lattice of the cube, and once we have the canonical orientation, it's the same for every, the, it's the same thing we'll get for every orientable cube. So we cannot, so this is the first remark, it's almost a remark. Then the second consequences of these general results are, and again, because the, every oriented orientable matroid, orientable cube will have a canonical orientation, is that whenever we can start thinking about an orientable cube oriented with canonical orientation. So to ask, so, we know a little bit of his family of circuits and of his family of co-circuits, which are the signed rectangles and the signed co-circuits complementary of the facets and skew facets, which are signed as in the real case. So the question, how many cubes are orientable, amounts to know, starting with these things, how much of the real cube hyperplane, so underlying matroid and orientation, can we reconstruct from these three things? Those, the signed rectangles, the signed facets, and just playing with orientability. Actually, we know also, whatever part, if we start building, whatever part we might end up with, it must have the symmetries of the affine and projective the same as the real cube. Because those families, R and F, have the same symmetries, exact the same group of symmetries. Finally, a consequence still of this, the fact that every orientable cube has a canonical orientation, is an exclusion. Every affine cube over a finite field, no one is orientable. They are not orientable. And this is a consequence of, if it was orientable, it would have a canonical orientation. And orientability, there is a circuit we can find for every n greater or equal than the characteristic of field plus 2, that means for all, that cannot be oriented. So there is a very fast way of finding that, proving that. So on general results, these are the general results. Then the second aspect, the second direction we looked for was to kind of find out obstructions to orientability inside a cube, trying to and we managed actually to have a general idea how to build families of new minor minimal non-oriented matroids. Starting, and the general idea is the following, generalizing existing ones. So we take, the general idea is take n points defining an hyperplane of the real cube, take the opposite hyperplane with respect to the center of the cube, take a point separated by the from the first of the hyperplanes by the other, and then if H, the first hyperplane, and the point O are in general position in that sense that we can pull, then pull O to H, and one obtains a good candidate to non-orientable, and then contracting by O a good candidate to minor minimal non-oriented matroid. And actually we did we obtained new families of minor minimal non-orientable matroids, all with two, all obtained like this, so two n points and rank n, which generalized the first example of an infinite family of non-orientable matroids, proving that orientability could not be characterized in terms of excluded minors. So here I put, we cannot argue in general. In the paper, I suggest a general construction, but cannot argue in general that it's true, it works always. But explicit examples are calculated for every n. So really new families for every n. So concerning obstructions, this is what we found. Finally, and now I come to a more recent topic or direction, which is looking at, again, explicitly, how much of the real cube can be constructed from the family of signed rectangles, signed co-circuits, complementary of the facets and skew facets, just using orientability axioms. The idea to start working with that is to find recursive families of hyperplanes of the real affine cube and try to reconstruct them, well, just from the data, which is that, to prove that they must belong to start, we start with an orientable cube, with in the canonical orientation and start proving that those families of hyperplanes and corresponding sinus circuits of the real affine metroid must be inside every canonically oriented cube. Okay. There is a variant. So here we want to reconstruct or to understand or to prove that recursive families of hyperplanes of the real cube, the hyperplanes and the corresponding signed co-circuits must be in every canonical oriented cube. A variant, which is not so strong, says, okay, assume the hyperplanes are there. So assume your underlying metroid is the real cube. Prove that only the signed co-circuits must be the same. Try to reconstruct the signed co-circuits of the real cube based on that information only. And here there is a cube of conjecture of Las Vernes saying that in this weaker reconstruction only of the sine circuits, the conjecture say, well, you will, what you will get is all the real affine cube. So supposing if you start by the underlying real affine cube, so not oriented, you have the real cube, not oriented. The conjecture says that if he is canonically oriented, from those families and orientably, you'll get all the orientation, all the signed co-circuits. Okay, so as an example of such a primitive recursive family, one has the vectors, the hyperplanes, orthogonal to this kind of vectors, which we call primitive, which are obtained in the following way. Here I only count positive, can add a zero. So we start with one, and they are increasing, and whenever we put one, we extend it with an element which is smaller or equal than half of the sum of the preceding ones plus one. That means we start with one, half of one is one half, so we only can extend with one or zero. We forget the zero. So with one, half of the sum is one, so we can have one, and one, two. And it goes on, starting here, 1, 1, 2, half is 2, so I can prolongate with 2 or 3, and so on. So for this kind of vectors, now this is vectors with integer in positive entrances, have very nice properties with respect to rectangles. If one considers the parallel strata they define on the cube, so by flats orthogonal to this primitive H, if we have a numerical rectangle, we choose levels A, B, C, D, satisfying this condition, then all the rectangles, they are always geometrically realizable. Inside the cube, there are actually vertices in all these levels which form a rectangle, Euclidean rectangle. On the other side, this property is rather important. If you have a strato such that every other parallel strato embeds in that one, and this embedding means that you have a tree of the complete graph on a level such that every edge of that tree forms forms a rectangle with an edge of the level SB, then essentially this SB is a hyperplane. It must be an hyperplane. 2 minutes. Okay. Must be an hyperplane. So this is actually, we can essentially prove that such family of hyperplanes must be in every orientable cube. And since the family of non-negative, this is the extended list of all the hyperplanes, and up till dimension 6, they are all primitive. So we can prove that up till 6, there is immediately, there is just one oriented cube, which is actually the real cube. For 7, the very few are non-primitive, but the same argument applies. So even for 7, this is true. Finally, so we get this theorem, and which was first proved by Bukowski in 96, but now is got with a very short proof, and we understand, explain, can follow it. Of course, this is work in progress to continue, and finally. Just how many cubes are orientable? Well, if one thinks of that there are, if one thinks that there are so many, and that they are invariant under pooling points to hyperplanes, there is a characterization of this operation which skips orientability. So, if one can find a pair hyperplane point in general position near each other in such a way that when we pull the point to hyperplane, we keep the orientability, well, then we have another example. Or we have other examples other than the affine cube. So far, no one found a pair hyperplane point in that situation. But on the other hand, maybe not so many. And there is a probabilistic conjecture which essentially says that the probability of finding a non-singular n by n matrix has to do with the probability of 3 of the 4 elements being on the rectangle. So this is all. So maybe some new results someone can help here. And the main reference are those for these results. And that's all. Thank you.
Do you have some question? Someone has a question.
Yes. Sorry, I might have missed this. So if you had a cube which was orientable, must the orientation be inherited by an orientation on the affine cube?
If you have a...
So if you were to find a cube that was orientable, the orientation have to be one that's inherited by the affine cube?
No, just a part of the orientation. The rectangles must be oriented as in the real cube, and the co-circuits complementary of the facets and skew facets too. But apart from that, nothing else. So there are lots of other circuits and other co-circuits.
I'm asking, can you show that it has to be I'm not asking about the definition, I'm asking, can you show that that such an orientation must be coming from the real affine cube? Because I'm asking this because then the question I think would be equivalent to, like, does the oriented matroid of the affine cube have any non-trivial weak map images? Something like that.
No.
Okay.
I don't see why.
Okay, I can ask.
We can talk. We can discuss this later. Maybe. I don't see why.
Do you have another question? Thank you, Hilda. Thank you.